Hello, good evening, everybody. Thanks for watching another live edition of Pittsburgh Sportsline in the BP TV studios. Got a great show for you scheduled tonight, talking some sports. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. Chip Hayner's with me. Smoking Jim Frazier's here. He was early. We all sat in here early, and now the show started. It's a shock.
We just sat here being early.
Yeah. We're all in the early mode. Thanks for all of you watching Comcast 7 in Bethel Park. Hear a lot of great feedback from you each week from your fans. And Verizon 32 is also in Bethel Park and all the way out to Cranberry, Wexford, and Nemacolin, and everywhere in between. We appreciate all the likes. And we hit a brand new high on Facebook, 6,502 likes. So it's quite the accomplishment. In about 4 years, we've been on Facebook. So keep watching our shows and liking us. We'll keep putting some sports out there for you to listen. We have a one-hour show. We started off with what's on your mind, and we're going to get to that in a minute. I got some promos. First is our sponsor, Olive Oils Pizzeria, 412-831-1900. How was that pizza smoking, Jim?
Best pizza he's eaten all day.
Best pizza you've eaten today.
Love it.
And that steak hoagie. I don't see that. Did that fall on the floor?
No, I took polish out of it.
Okay, I wasn't sure, but check them out right at Hillcrest Shopping Center. Give them a call. They have a special tonight till 8 o'clock, a large pizza with one topping, $5. And yes, I said $5. 412-831-1900. Give them a call.
I was wondering why Jim asked me for $4.50.
he's always working that. Well, he's trying to stay healthy now that he's working out three times a week.
Yeah, gluten-free, right?
Oh, everything. Look at him there. He looks like $1 million. Whoa, not at me. They're looking at me. Here we go. Joey Fabus, always end the show with Stay Joey Strong. The poor young man didn't live till his ninth birthday. He had brain cancer, VIPG. They're going to have their race coming up, 5K Walker Run in September, so stay tuned for that. We'll have more information. Go to their website, Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation. Donate $1. Donate your time. Check it out. Support some of the events that they have. They just had a flea market a week or so ago and did really well. Another charitable organization that's great in Bethel Park, the Bethel Park Historical Society, the Schoolhouse Arts and History Center is right there on South Park Road. It has the trolley. Yes, I said trolley right out front that's been refurbished there. Check it out. They rent out the building, so if you need an antiquated building that's going to have new windows, check it out. I think they may have room for you. Not sure what the rent rates are, but that's the Bethel Park Historical Society Schoolhouse Arts and History Center. Then we got a new helper here at Bethel Park tonight. Noah is here. Uncle Al wants you to help at BP TV. Call 412-831-3304. Talk to Dave Cable. Yes, that's his name. Dave Cable, director of BP TV. He put my face on this Uncle Sam thing, and Mr. Bold saw me the other day and said, "You really look great in that commercial." And Smokin' Jim pumps me up. That's the best commercial he's ever seen. So I want you. All right, BP Community Foundation. They have money for your organization in Bethel Park to help your group. If you have kids, if you do things in the community, $100 to $5,000 is available. Check it out. Get an application at bpcf.org and check out all the good things that they are doing in the community. All right, now we go to What's on Your Mind, Smokin' Jim Frazier.
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And if you want the green,
it's coming at you high and hard.
You got to see Levine. Almost dove for that one. Felt like Steve Largent.
And you look good in the great green Pittsburgh sports line.
I'm hooked up with the Pittsburgh sports line shirt. I got my man Devin Shea hooked me up with a Penguins cap. And Penguins are my second favorite sports franchise. right behind Golden State and my Cubbies.
Hold it, excuse me, folks. Smoking Jim's an NFL scout, and he always has a top 10 list with about 13 to 15 teams. And if you noticed, he said Golden State and the Cubbies.
2A, 2B.
When he said there was one other team. So just a little clarification with my man. He's back in full form after his quadruple bypass. Great to see you working out. And Haley, make sure you whip him into shape tomorrow.
Beautiful lady, beautiful Haley. But hey, in honor of the Tour de France, I've added a minute to my stationary bike this week, so I'm all in. But hey, something.
So what? You're up to a minute and a half now.
No, he's up. No, he got 2 minutes.
All I do, I ride and watch Haley. Boy, she's beautiful. You... But hey.
Don't give away all your secrets.
Hey, the face, you know. The fans of Pittsburgh Sports Line always want me to update them on what's out there in Facebook. And Facebook had a poll
today. They don't really care.
As the 10 worst suburban neighborhoods. So I just felt like I'll read those.
As he's here, he usually goes to the negative. We try to have a positive show from me and Chip.
He
goes right to the negative. Right to the negative, and if he brings out any color or anything, I'll jump right on that. So take it away, Smoking Jim Frazier.
Number one.
This is worst, what your fans want from you.
The worst suburban neighborhood in Pittsburgh is Duquesne, followed closely by number two, Clareton, number three, North Braddock, number four, Aliquippa, number five, McKeesport, home of Dana Brown of the Pittsburgh Wildcats, who had 6 sacks this past weekend.
How did you know?
Football player.
Did you see him?
I seen the stats.
Oh.
Number 6 is Ambridge. I'm a little surprised Ambridge is that high up. Our good friend of the show, you know, Gabriel Baker, the touchdown makers from there. How about Beaver Falls? Figure they'd be higher than 7th. Homestead. Coming in at number 8, Vandergriff. Where's that at, Chip?
It's out Route 56.
Yeah, that's bad.
Okay.
And number 10, last but not least, is Sharpsburg. I want to recount, how the heck is Penn Hills not in the top 10? I'm sure Penn Hills will be in the top 10 next
year. There you go, putting your personal opinion into this.
There's no way Penn Hills is not in the top 10, man. They're in the league of all. They're in the league all their own.
How can you even have a discussion on the 10 worst and you toss an 11th in there?
There you go.
How does this even happen?
I want to recount.
For all the fans of Smoking Jim, you're seeing a side that this is how he is. He's looking for negative. Give him some more negative.
And congratulations again to the Pittsburgh Wildcats, undefeated again this year in the regular season. Paul Jones, one of the best high school quarterbacks ever seen. And he broke the semi-pro single season record. So those guys should be looking to get in the Hall of Fame one day, because there is a semi-pro football Hall of Fame in Canton as well. And they're working their way through, and I hope the NFL give Paul Jones an NFL shot.
Why don't you contact somebody, NFL scout? They're counting on you.
Yeah.
They even expected you at their game.
Well, one of the hardest.
They were so disappointed 2 weeks ago you didn't show up.
Two hardest things to break into the NFL is being a white cornerback and a black quarterback. So Paul Jones is fighting an uphill battle.
Maybe you can help him. Maybe you can help him, since you don't see color very often.
Maybe he has an easier time getting his picture up on the Homestead Bridge.
They don't put any pictures up on that
bridge. Yeah, they got pictures of the Homestead graves up there. And that's what's on my mind.
I think their pictures go up posthumously. That means after they're dead. After they died.
I was going to.
It took them a long time.
I was going to look that one up.
Don't even worry about it, Smokey Jim. Thanks for your what's on your mind. Chip Hainer, what's on your mind?
Oh, thank you, Alan, and good evening, everybody. Welcome to our humble sports talk show. Number of things are on my mind. in case nobody noticed, the Pittsburgh Pirates have fought their way back into a pennant race. Their record now, after 100 games, stands at 50-50. And 3 short weeks ago, the Pirates were 9 games under 500. So hats off to the Buccos on the North Shore.
My Cubbies is in first place.
No, they're not.
Mm-hmm. Tied for first tonight.
Well, after tonight's games, it'll maybe be determined. They're a half game behind. So, don't, you know, not yet. Not yet. But, you know, good news on the North Shore. Going to be a lot of exciting baseball the next 62 games. Starting tonight at 10:15, where Jameson Taillon going up against Madison Bumgarner. Madison Bumgarner, by the way, shut out the Pirates in the wild card game a couple of years ago. Mowed down through everybody in the World Series, the playoff series.
Was undefeated,
won 3 games in the World Series. World Series MVP. His record as it stands for this season, he's 0-4. And in the six
he
games,
was off.
In
he
the
was
six
off.
Games that he started this year, the Giants are 0-6, soon to be 0-7. So that's part of what's on my mind. Also, a little bit of excitement coming out of the South Side, maybe heading out towards Latrobe, St. Vincent's. We've got Steeler training camp. Thursday, the players check in. They get their conditioning tests done. And first day of practice is on Friday. So that's something that to look forward to. But what's really on my mind, what seemed to be the big topic of conversation today, had to do with a report that was released in regards to the CTE problem with deceased NFL players. Now, there's been a number of NFL players, and I think there was like over 202 players from high school, college, and from the pro ranks who donated their brains to this study. And of the 202 that had, took part in the study, 170 of them had some form of CTE, which is a degenerative brain disease. And of the NFL players whose brains that they examined that were donated, 110 out of 111 had varying degrees of CTE. Now, you know, of course, this does raise a lot of eyebrows, but if you think about it, most of the people that had decided to donate their brains to be studied were people that were already showing signs of the disease. Mm-hmm. So there's really not a real good sample size because you can't diagnose this affliction until the person's deceased and they do cross sections of the brain. So, you know, the point of the matter is that they don't believe that it was one big hit that caused these conditions in people, but it was the repeated smaller concussive hits that caused this. And the thing that a lot of debate was going about today is how this is affecting youth football leagues in and around the area, because now parents are less inclined to allow their young children, 7, 8 years old, to start putting on pads and clobbering heads with one another because of the effects that it may have on them later in life. And that just, you know, got me thinking, and I'm like, you know, there's a lot of good discussions about, you know, what age is too young for young potential athletes to begin to start hitting with pads and helmets in football. Some people say that they shouldn't start hitting probably until they're 13, 14 years old. But, you know, other people have varying other opinions. Like my friend Jim thinks they should, you know, as soon as they come out of the womb, you should get them a custom fit helmet, and they should start right then. But, you know,
their heads are still soft. They're not fully developed yet.
The thing that got me thinking is that this is a very real thing. And this is something that 7, 8 years ago we really didn't know much about. And the NFL fought very hard to let this information get out. Now that it's out, it makes you think about what is going to happen to the game of professional football, maybe not now, but maybe 10, maybe 20 years down the road. It'll be interesting to see, but that's what's on my mind.
Just so you know, Chip, football enrollment is up in midget football Monroeville.
And just so you know, Chip, last week, Smokin' Jim declared that he had been hit many times and concussed.
I ain't donating no brain.
But you want to know something? I heard a caller today who ran the youth football programs in Upper St. Clair. And Upper St. Clair is a hotbed of football. You know, Jim Render, the Hall of Fame
he
coach.
Knows him.
Well, they said that participation in their midget football leagues has dwindled on a consistent basis, and to the point where he said, if this was a business and we were running this business, we'd fold it at this point. But, Garfield, parents are less inclined.
Garfield Gators can't get enough kids in there. It's packed for kids to play for Garfield.
But
what's the record?
But without trying to be disparaging, Jim, but for, a lot of, those children, that may be their way out of the neighborhood, where you've got the kids in Upper St. Clair who come from better, the
you
sons
like some of the
doctors and
there.
Lawyers nice who may have better options available to them. Nice but, houses. Your point is taken. It depends on where you look at the statistics. They're always going to be skewed one way or another. You can go one at one place and they'll be leaning towards this side, go somewhere else. So, it's...
I know I do rehab in Murraysville and the kids aren't playing football out there because they're soft.
Okay.
What does that mean? And he's been concussed. He's walked in the walls.
I'm not trying to point the finger at anybody. I'm just saying children's parents are now more cautious about letting their kids become projectiles with a helmet on. And, we'll see what happens.
Put a skirt on them, the words of Jack Lambert.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Smoke and Jim's still living in the 70s, 80s. He's a little delirious.
So,
we love Smoking Jim, but his opinions are truly his own opinions.
I heard some very interesting discussions for and against, this. And it makes you think, I'm willing to listen to what both sides have to say, forming my own opinion, and I haven't formed it yet.
Makes sense. I just feel that athletes are athletes, and the later they start in football, I'm all for it.
It'll be interesting to see how this trends.
I think all these athletes that want to be great football players, let them play other sports, get their joints stronger, have athletic ability, and test it in volleyball, swimming.
That's something.
Do those type of things because the variety of that, I feel, makes them stronger.
Dick Groat, who was a Hall of Famer in baseball and in basketball, played professional. He said that the problem with a lot of athletes these days is that they only play one sport. He said when he was a kid, one time of the year they played basketball, and then they played baseball, and then they played football. But they were always playing a different sport all the time. And now you see kids that are specialists, and the athletes seem to be more fragile than they were back in the old days.
Look at our man Smoking Jim Frazier. He's on a bike.
Prohibition. He was a great one, though.
No, he played
basketball, too, at Duke.
Yeah, he played basketball. Duke, he played
late
in the 50s. NBA, did he not?
Mm-hmm.
And then he also played Major League Baseball.
Yeah.
The best of the best.
I got to agree with him. Matter of fact, I'm on that page. Thanks for having him co-sign that. No, I think they should play a bunch of different sports, stick to it, instead of all these quitters after one season. They quit.
No participation trophies.
Yeah.
How about the Alabama recruit?
Eighth grade?
6'4", 286, running a 4'7", 40.
Yeah, and you see, Nick Saban sitting there right?
Yeah.
Did his picture taken with him? I'm sure that's going to be an NCAA violation.
Yeah, yesterday the recruit already scratched Pitt off his list.
Smoking Jim Frazier. We appreciate your positivity, as always. We appreciate that. Thanks, Chip. Can't say I disagree with these studies, and CTE is definitely a problem.
Something you should educate yourself about.
Well, more and more people are, and they are limiting their children with some of this stuff. So, but others, they're fanatics like Smoking Jim. You get hit and you're walking dizzily, and get back out there and hit them harder.
That's right.
Rub dirt in it, take a lap.
No, don't even rub dirt in it.
Hey, if you're not throwing up, you don't have a concussion.
Folks, I hate to offend you, but I'll put another disclaimer. Smoking Jim is an NFL scout, all about the sport. His actual theory is like an emperor, that they're all pieces of meat. And if you can't play and get yourself in shape to play, he don't want anything to do with you. And this is Smoking Jim over the last October 11th, it'll be 6 years we've been talking sports like this. He hasn't changed one bit, except now he knows that Babe Ruth is not a Pirate fan. That's the one good thing that he found out. Babe Ruth does not look over the Pirate
Base
fans.
You and Chip, I learned a lot of baseball.
No, you know, Jim found out that Babe Ruth is not just a candy bar.
Yeah, he said he likes those Baby Ruths.
But Babe Ruth is black. We're claiming him.
It's too late. It's too late, buddy. You got to read some history on him. But I gave you the book. You missed it. 17 pages. That's it. All right, what's on my mind is Penguins. Penguins signed a defenseman, Dumoulin, for $4.1 million for 6 years. I like the length of the contract. He'll be 25, I think, at the end of the month or in August. He's a great defensive defenseman. And what does that mean? He doesn't score a lot of points. He helps to set up the offense. He helps Letang out when he's running wild. He can stay back. And he's just a great type of aggressive defenseman, which you see in hockey. And they're getting rewarded to make money like that. 6 year contract. I think that's great. I like the length of time. Some think he got overpaid, maybe a little bit. But they're paying $4 million for guys that truly suck as defensemen. So, I mean, this was a good deal. I'm glad to see now Penguins have another $6.2 million under the cap that they could spend. So we'll see what else they do here. They need a third-line center. Not sure what's going on there yet, so we'll find out by the time preseason starts.
I think Matt Cullen will be back in a Penguin sweater next year.
It's leaning that way.
It's leaning that way. But, you know, the thing that made signing Ryan Dumoulin such a smart move is for the type of defenseman that he is, that's what the going rate is. And what they're doing is, if, you know, 3 years from now, that same player is probably going to be worth $6 or $7 million. Locking him up for 6 years at 4.1, you know, they're doing themselves, he'll be very cap friendly as we move forward. And, you know, with the kind of firepower, the offensive firepower that the Penguins have, having an offensive defenseman is a luxury that you can afford to have because you don't need to rely on him to score goals for you. Now, they do have two offensive defensemen in Justin Schultz and Chris Letang. You know, they need that stay-at-home guy, and Dumoulin played more minutes than any other defenseman in the on the team this playoff run, and he was a plus nine for the Stanley Cup playoffs, which was the highest plus minus score. But the Penguins defensemen in the NHL playoffs this year were plus 35 as a unit, which, you know, you really can't ask for better than that. By that I mean, Jim, they scored 35 more goals than were scored against them when they were on the ice.
That's a good thing.
I'll take that.
That's a positive thing, smoking Jim.
I like to help my brother out.
You know? Hey, and that's what's on my mind. Thanks, guys, and we'll be right back.
Hi, Bethel Park. Remember me? My name is Jason Planetzer. I was the host of a little show here. You may have seen it. It was called the Jason Planetzer Show.
What would you say your experience at BPTV, how has that had an impact on your life?
I found my voice. I learned how to be funny. I learned how to create things. I learned how to collaborate with people here. I developed an interest in film and comedy and making videos. It stuck with me. It continued through my life. I got into working on motion pictures. I now I'll produce small videos. I'll work with producers on commercials, television projects, feature films. I scout locations on TV shows and movies, which involves me reading scripts, finding the locations that need to be shot, and collaborating with the director and production designer to find the perfect spot. It all started at BPTV for me.
Thank you.
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine.
Great graphic, Smoking Jim. That fiction and fact is awesome.
Hey, I just got an update on some news that I just found out today. So if everybody can tune in, you never know when it's my last shot, but KDKA Radio 1020 gave me a call and invited me to be a guest Sunday on the Chris Moore Show from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock. They usually don't give me more than an hour. You got a four-hour show, but I get the first hour, and I'm kind of surprised that KDKA keeps bringing me on every year. But I appreciate them doing it.
They like the highlights.
Is this the kickoff of training camp? Are we going to talk in football?
Yes. Yeah, well, I think we're going to talk a little bit of all sports. You know, we got to talk a little bit about my Buccos and Penguins, too.
I might have to call them.
Pardon me? Did you stutter or something? Your Buccos?
I might have to call and fill in some of the blanks for you.
That's it. I appreciate it, man.
What's that phone
Everybody's
number?
Everybody's welcome to call it. I forget the number. But
yeah, of course. Yeah. Will you answer?
Yeah. They answer. Yeah, they ask who it is. I go, this is Al Levine, the talking machine.
Him and Chris Moore go at it pretty good, man.
Yeah, I try to put out some positive things for my man.
But I'm going to try to give everybody a shout out if I can when I'm on KDKA.
And they have so many commercials. I don't know how you get a chance to talk.
The hour's quick. It goes quick.
We only talk about 18 minutes.
That's about it. And Chip talking about the Buccos being over there and on the West Coast. Have there ever been any rainouts this year?
Not on the
talking the weather. I'm going with McGregor over Mayweather. Thanks, Chip. But my fiction of fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac goes all the way back to February of 1978. Biggest upset in sports history when Leon Spinks, who was 6-0-1, beat the greatest of all time, the GOAT, the greatest of all time, Muhammad Ali. It was the biggest upset in boxing history. A guy that came in there with only 6 wins and no losses in a tie. Leon Spinks went on to a record of 26 wins, 17 losses, and 3 draws. And so all you that's out there that's not giving McGregor a chance, I know Rookie of the Year, Steve, my man Steve back there in the control room, he and I are on the same page with McGregor. He does good things in the community. But this guy is an animal. And if somebody with only 6 wins can beat the greatest of all time, Muhammad Ali, how can somebody not think that McGregor could beat Mayweather in who is 2 years retired, coming out of retirement on that fight in August. We got plenty of time to talk McGregor and Mayweather between now and August 26th.
Let's just talk about the regular weather.
Yeah, there you go.
It was a little chilly today.
That's it. And that's the picture.
Forget about Mayweather and McGregor.
Smoking Jim's Almanac.
I like how you segued into that, Smoking Jim. Not going to happen.
You don't think?
You lost 5 houses last year. You're betting a house this year. It's not the Patriots.
Putting it on?
Yeah, it's not going to happen. I feel bad for you. I know you didn't spend that $99 on getting the fight.
But one thing I did spend, what? I watched in one day season 1 and 2 of Ballers.
Who cares?
Yeah, I never see that show. I'm hooked on it now. So that's it. It's good football stuff.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. The Rock. Rock stars. Nice suits.
Good.
A lot of good-looking girls.
Thank you, Smoking Jim, for fiction and fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac. We got a lot of fiction tonight, folks. We're looking for the facts.
I love my music. Oh, good evening, everybody, and welcome to my trivia segment. And got some interesting trivia that I've pulled out of the, I don't know, out of wherever it is I pull my trivia out of. But we'll go in chronological order, order, and I'll start with July the 19th. In 1910, greatest pitcher to ever play the game of baseball. Cy Young registered his 500th career victory as the Indians beat the Senators in 11 innings. And yes, he did pitch all 11 innings. And in 1960, year I was born, this was 2.5 months before I was born, Juan Marichal broke in with the San Francisco Giants, pitching a 1-hit, 2-0 victory over the Philadelphia Phillies. Juan Marichal was had quite an interesting windup, to say the least. And this one, I'll go all the way back to 2015.
Wow.
On July the 19th, after 20 years and 1,609 games, consecutive home games, the Los Angeles Angels finally lost another game to rain. Heavy rain, heavy downpours turned Angel Stadium's outfield into a virtual marshland, forcing the postponement of their game against the Boston Red Sox. So, 20 years.
He asked about the weather.
Not
he
bad.
Must have been cheating at your sheet.
Not bad for the
there's the weather out in
okay,
California.
So now we'll move up to July the 20th in 1958. I mentioned this guy last week, Jim Bunning, pitched one of his no-hitters. And also in 1970, July 20th, Bill Singer of the Dodgers pitched a no-hitter as well. I always like to make note of these things because these are events that don't happen very often. Mm-hmm. Next on the greatest home run hitter of all time,
Barry Bonds.
Hank Aaron of the Atlanta Braves hit his 700th home run on July the 21st, 1973. And ironically enough, Aaron connected off of a 1-1 fastball off of the Phillies pitcher, Ken Brett. Remember that last name? It's going to connect to something a little later on here. Next, we shall move on to July the 23rd. July the 23rd of 1925.
Whoa!
The Iron Horse. You know who the Iron Horse was, right?
Oh, yeah.
Lou Gehrig, yeah. Hit the first of his major league record 23 Grand Slam home runs.
Wow.
As the Yankees posted an 11-7 triumph over the Washington Senators. And also, this was a game that both Alan Levine and myself were spectators at. July the 23rd, 1974. Write-in starter Steve Garvey of the Los Angeles Dodgers singled and doubled to lead the National League to a 7-2 victory over the American League in the All-Star Game at Three Rivers Stadium.
I remember it well.
Mm-hmm.
Sitting way still, up high in the stadium.
Still have my ticket stub.
Oh, yeah?
July the 24th, you know, 1947 was the year that the color barrier was broken in Major League Baseball. Jackie Robinson stole home for the first time on July the 24th, 1947. I think that's an art in the game of baseball that has been lost. One of the most exciting plays in the game, stealing a home.
Yeah.
Also, one of the most infamous plays that ever happened in the history of baseball happened on July the 24th, 1983. And it was considered the Pine Tar Incident.
Oh, yeah, right.
And remember, the pitcher that gave up Hank Aaron's home run was Ken Brett. Well, Ken Brett's younger brother, George Brett, was the author of this one. And to refresh people's memory, the Pine Tar home run was hit by Kansas City Royals' George Brett off of Goose Gossage at Yankee Stadium. Brett's shot came with two outs in the top of the ninth to give the Royals a 5-4 lead. Brett's homer was ruled an out because the amount of pine tar on the bat exceeded what was allowed. After a protest by the Royals, the final out in the Yankees' half of the ninth was completed on August the 18th. Now, how this all came about was that Yankees manager Billy Martin, who was always up to some type of shenanigans, had noticed earlier in the series that George Brett had pine tar up a little too far on his bat. And what the rule was that you're only allowed to have pine tar on the end of the bat as long as the width of the plate, which usually was right just underneath the trademark on the bat. Well, George Brett and other hitters would try to cheat and get a little bit more pine tar further up the bat to help, maybe help them with hitting, whatever it was that they felt that gave them advantage. And Billy Martin said nothing about that until that game in the ninth inning when he hit a home run. And then he said, oh, by the way, And he came out and he pointed that out to the umpires. The umpires had a consultation. They measured the pine tar. They ruled him out. George Brett flipped out. Mm. But Billy Martin knew when to play his cards. He was an old poker player.
Yeah. So, what year was that?
1983.
Okay, Bo Jackson went on the Royals. Yeah.
No, wasn't thought of yet.
No, and there was one other thing I meant to mention here on the 23rd. Let me see.
But Ken Brett and George Brett were really brothers?
Yes, they were.
I never knew that.
But
how would you?
On July the 25th.
You didn't even know they played ball.
On July the 25th of 1941, one of the greatest years in the history of baseball,
yeah.
Lefty Grove of the Boston Red Sox won his 300th game and last game, beating the Cleveland Indians 10-6. And last but certainly not least, and this is the only time this happened in the history of Major League Baseball.
Whoa.
July 25th, 1956, a rookie right fielder hit an inside the park.
I know it.
Walk-off grand slam home run in the bottom of the ninth, and his name was Roberto Clemente.
Really? And his coaches were mad that he ran through the third base.
He ran through the stop sign at third base, and he actually, when he slid home, he slid past home plate and missed the plate and then reached back with his hand and rested it on top of the plate.
Yeah.
The Pirates were losing to the Chicago Cubs 8-5. It was the bottom of the ninth, and Clemente was up with the bases loaded, and he hit a ball into the off of one of the light standards in Forbes Field.
Wow.
And the ball went parallel to the field, and out and the left fielder had to chase after the ball. And by the time he brought it back in, and Clemente, the third base coach was calling Clemente to stop, and he was like...
Well, he didn't understand English.
Well, he understood plenty. He knew that no matter what, even if he was thrown out, because there was two outs, even if he's thrown out, the game's still tied, and they play the 10th inning. But if he scores,
he was an aggressive player.
No need to play anymore. So that has never happened in Major League Baseball history. Before or since, a walk-off inside the park grand slam home run.
I never knew that. Good stuff.
Definitely.
July the 25th. That was 61 years ago.
Wow.
62 years
ago. Yeah,
61 years ago.
62.
Thanks, Chip.
61.
Thanks, Chip. I appreciate that. I like my music, too. All right, On Location. Had a great show last week, On Location. Before we go any further, I wanted to thank Marianne from Isuzu for the haircut. Got the haircut. Forgot to talk about it last week. We got caught up with too much sports and Smoking Jim bringing out his things he didn't know about baseball and weather and whatever else we had going on. It was hard to keep track. But, yeah, thanks, Marianne and Isuzu. Always a pleasure. Emilio down there, the owner, great guy and a sports fan. We'll be August 7th. We'll be back at Hollywood Lanes. I had a phone call from a big fan of our show, Dave Ferretti. He said he met the principal of Cannon Mack High School, and he's a very nice guy. Wow. Here he actually has watched our show, Pittsburgh Sportsline. He knew of the talking machine.
Wow.
So I called him up. He's a young man. Lives nearby, near Millennium Fields, in a new plan of houses. Talked to him for a minute or two, and we agreed that his head basketball coach should come in, Mike Evans.
Wow.
And that's his football coach, I'm sorry. And his basketball coach is Rick Bell. Mm-hmm. Here I know Rick Bell's brother. He sold me a couple cars at Bob Smith Ford.
Wow.
So it's a small world, so we're going to have a Cannon Mack edition for at least half of the show, because they're all three coming on our show, Smoking Jim.
What day?
That's August 7th.
All right.
Yeah, so we're lined up there. You never know where you meet people and have watched our show, and they're happy to come on and know about us, so they can't wait to be on the show. Talk
now,
to all three.
The soccer coach, he was from there too, right? That we interviewed up at...
I don't know.
At the golf course? What was he from? Cannon Mack, I think. Girls soccer coach.
No, I thought they were Peters Township, I thought.
Cannon Mack. I got a good memory for
him. I think it was
Girl
Peters.
Soccer.
And Mike Evans, you'll be surprised where he coached at. So.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, he's just been coaching at Cannon Mac the last 2 years, and he sees some improvement for their football team. So we'll talk about that. You two will have some fun and can bond about a couple things.
Cool.
So we have a nice, exciting show, August 7th, 7:30 to 8:30. Come up and see Jeffrey Park. He just got his liquor license, so now he can sell booze to you. And
wow,
we got great things happening at Hollywood Lanes. We'll see you then.
I've shown an interest in making home movies. Me and some buddies would just grab a camera and just start making these videos. And then you realize at some point that this isn't just a hobby anymore. It's something that you actually want to pursue. And there's this great facility right down the road, BPTV. A lot of people will try to do these productions on their own. And one of the things they don't have is the equipment, you know. But right here is everything that you need in one nice little bundle. There's lights, cameras, reflectors, dollies, all kinds of little knickknacks, like anything that you'd want to use that you would need for a production, you have it right here. Like, it's all right here. You can make your own feature movie just with the stuff from this studio. Come meet Dave Cable, let him show you around, and I think you'll realize that this is something that you could fall into regardless of your level of expertise, whether you're a beginner or even if you're a more advanced learner. There's something here for everyone, and I feel that you just need to come through and just be a part of the experience and just watch and learn, and you know, let Dave be your guide.
We got some Steeler talk. First off, they're honoring the late, great, deceased Dan Rooney with a patch with his initials on it. It's like a three-leaf clover, a black one. It'll be on their uniform. So
black and gold.
Be a nice thing to
be on their right chest.
Yeah, so it'll be good to see that. Le'Veon Bell has not done anything yet. Still not being paid enough. That rap song he had of $15 million per year. He's serious about that. He thinks he should get $15 million per year. He has yet to finish a full season or play one.
But see, the unfortunate part for him is that he doesn't get a chance to negotiate because the players' union, in a collectively agreed-upon bargain, Steelers don't have to pay him more than 12.1, and he can't play for any more than that this year because he didn't decide to take the offer that the Steelers put on the table for him, which would have been much higher because the second highest paid running back's getting, what, $8.5 million?
Yeah.
That's LeSean McCoy?
Yeah.
So, you know, I guess being the highest paid running back in football isn't good enough for him, but no, well.
Well, he's a second leading receiver, so he wants a combo to his pay.
Yeah, and you know, maybe he forgot about the fact
73
that he's also
receptions mean something.
Missed drug test or failed drug test away from having a 1 year suspension. And in the first 4 years in the league, he hasn't finished the season yet. So, you know, before he starts wanting $15 million, show me you can make it through all 16. But on another note, breaking news, Sammy Coates will be absent from camp. Had his knee scoped. And, of course, it probably made great sense to do that 2 days before camp started, being that you've had the last 6 months to get that knee cleaned up. But
I was hoping they'd scope his hand with the breaks he had and the way his hand looked.
He's got fingers that point to all 4 points on the compass.
Yeah, I think he needed a hand scope there.
Yeah.
For sure.
So it looks like Juju Smith will end up being one of our top three receivers this year. You know, you'll have Martavis on one side, Antonio Brown on the other, and Juju will be the slot receiver. What do you think?
Well, Jim? He got to beat out Eli Rogers, who's who's one of the favorites of Coach Mike Tomlin.
Ben liked him a lot last year, too.
So Juju, coming from USC, where he got to spend a lot of time with athletic director Lynn Swan.
And your point is?
He's probably a little bit further advanced than most 19-year-old kids coming out of college, but did he take
ballerina lessons?
Well, that did him good, you know.
Let's cut right to the chase, Jim. What do you think the Steelers got in them this year?
Second fiddle. They'll be second fiddle to New England Patriots as long as Keith Butler's the defensive coordinator.
And what does that mean? What do you mean?
What do you
by
mean
this?
Record-wise?
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think the Pittsburgh Steelers, because I haven't looked at their schedule, but they are capable of 11-5.
Okay.
That's enough to win their division. And they play New England in Pittsburgh. And
December 17th. And the best part about that game is that New England's playing on a short week that week. And it'll be the third of three road games they have in a row. They'll play the first one in Buffalo, the next one in Miami. And then they come to Pittsburgh on a short week. So
Thursday night football.
You know, so it will, it could bode well for the Steelers. But you know what?
How's that man-to-man coverage going to be?
Well, that's the next question I wanted to make, you know, because, okay, Artie Burns showed some promise last year, and I'm not ready to award him a position on the Pro Bowl. And, you know, you still have Willie Gay, who's not gotten a step faster. Obviously the secondary is a huge question mark. Okay, and now we've got a guy who's entering, is he entering the third or fourth year of his contract, Senquez Golston, and he hasn't played a down yet. So,
his third year.
Yeah, it's his third year, and he has not yet seen the field in a regular season game.
Good baseball player, too.
Well, is he?
Let's go to Pirates. If
talk.
I didn't see him on the trainer's table, you know, I don't know what he can or can't do. Supposedly, he's supposed to be a good athlete, but he had that Lisfranc injury last year. And there's a lot of guys that never recover from Lisfranc injuries that could be a career ender. So, is that another wasted draft pick?
Well, there's an opening for a head coach at Ole Miss, his alma mater, but,
we might take it.
Steelers were real high on him. You know, he had a lot of, knocks against him coming out because he's short. Never going to get any taller. And then you got some foot problems that's going to affect your jumping ability and running and cutting ability. So, and he had shoulder problems his first year, so I don't think the Pittsburgh Steelers are counting on him right now. What was he, a second round draft pick?
Yes.
That's a little bit high. You want to depend on your first and second round draft picks to contribute. He hasn't yet, going into his third year, may never. Think that's the same season they took Sammy Coates.
Did do you
what a draft. That, do you agree that draft was a D now? Yeah. Him and Sammy Coates are the same draft.
What do you think about what should Bud Dupree's impact on the defense be this year?
Well, when you have a neutral defensive coordinator, Keith Butler, whose brain is stuck in neutral all the time. Nothing against him. He's a linebacker coach. He's defense coordinator is above his pay scale, but they promoted him anyway. But you got a guy like Bud Dupree, you put him at left outside linebacker, put him at right outside linebacker because he could be a real force. Why put him at left? He could still get 10 sacks at left, but he can be double teamed and get 12 sacks at right outside linebacker, and that would open things up for TJ Watts can move over to the left side. But the smartest move would be to put Ryan Shazier at right outside linebacker, but they're still going to probably start a 40-year-old James Harrison.
He's not just your ordinary 40-year-old James Harrison. Yeah. I mean, this man is a marvel. I've seen his workouts.
Yeah.
He
$1,000 a day he spends on health stuff to stay healthy. A thousand a day.
I watched him hauling around 1,800 pounds on a sled. And
I just saw that.
And I'm telling you, if I could do that when I was 40, man, he's a freak of nature.
Well, did you hear that they're talking about letting James Harrison start the season and then TJ will come into the second half of the season and play?
Well, you know, I think what worked real well for the Steelers last year is they didn't use James a whole lot in the beginning part of the season. And then during the stretch drive and the playoff run, James was fresh.
Yeah.
You know, because that's you know, I mean, a win, you know, you got to win the games early in the season to make the games late in the season count. But, you know, when all the chips are on the line, you know, James was there and he played very solid.
Who are they going to have next to Shazier in the middle one?
Well, yeah, Vince Williams seems to be the heir apparent to Lawrence Timmons.
Yeah, he's a great leader. Couldn't keep his younger brother off of marijuana. He's suspended for a year.
But you promote marijuana everywhere with the blunts. You're a blunt man.
But do you see, as much as you've always complained that you felt that Shazier should be an outside linebacker, not an inside linebacker, and looking at how well he's played as an inside linebacker, definitely see him being a Pro Bowl caliber inside linebacker this year.
Well, the problem you have with Shazier playing inside, Shazier could be an all-pro safety. He's just an athlete. But playing inside linebacker, he's been nicked up every year. He's the Le'Veon Bell of, playing that position, and because he's built like a basketball player. And the only guy I ever seen built like that that was able to play pretty much injury-free and go to the Pro Bowl every year was Jack Lambert. And so Shazier, at right outside linebacker, you can use your athletic ability. It's almost like being a point guard. You can use your athletic ability more so than getting caught up in a junk in the middle.
Well, I think, you know, one of the keys to Shazier being effective is – an inside backer is going to be Stephon Tuitt, Cam Hayward, and Javon Hargrave. Mm-hmm. And I think going into the season, I think that's probably one of the strongest defensive lines the Steelers have had since Aaron Smith and Big Snack were holding down in Brett DeKeysel, which was 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you've got a good defensive line, then that frees up your linebackers to make plays. You know, part of the problem in the past, and it, you know, is you, if you got them big 330 pounders all over Shazier, of course he's going to get knocked around. He's going to get hurt. He's not going to be able to make plays.
Well, the only problem is, and I agree with your theory, but that's why 4-3 is always better for inside linebacker because you got four down linemen to keep the offensive line off, but. The reason that Big Snack was so successful in the 3-4 was because he demanded a double team.
Every play.
I don't see a nose guard demanding a double team. So as long as your nose guard is not getting double teamed, that frees a guy up to get to Shazier's leg. So, but I think Jerry O does a good job with as a linebacker coach. He's been working on Shazier to keep the garbage off his legs. He's been working on a lot of technique. But I just think that's just like putting Michael Jordan at center. He could be a Hall of Famer at center, but boy, he could be the greatest player of all time at guard. And just like Shazier, he could be the greatest player of all time at right outside linebacker. It's a position perfect for him, 4-3, 40, all the athletic ability in the world.
Well, you know,
next to Eric Thomas.
Going into the season, everybody is picking the Patriots and the Steelers. And the Raiders is the cream of the crop in the AFC.
The Raiders, too.
The Raiders. Wow. Well, if Derek Carr stays healthy, I mean, up until the time when he got hurt, the Raiders were forced to be reckoned with last fall.
They can't beat my Kansas City Chiefs.
Yeah. That's an interdivisional play.
Kansas City got a good quarterback, too. He was the number one pick overall.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We saw what he did. We took him to school on a Sunday night. I remember I watched that game in the rain.
He just don't like throwing touchdowns to wide receivers. What, they went a whole season 1 year without the wide receivers
didn't need him.
So, okay, then, it'll be interesting to see how, what really is going to determine how well the Steelers do, how many people show up. can play on Sundays. Keep people healthy. I think the Steelers have as good a chance as any. Do I see the Patriots repeating this year? Absolutely not.
Well, they'll beat the Steelers. That's all they care about.
Yeah. You know,
we will see.
We will see.
We'll see what happens
but
with that.
We got a couple of minutes left. We got to go. Wow, we got to talk Buccos. You know, the Pirates, three short weeks ago, they were 9 games under .500.
Yeah.
And look at what has happened. McCutchen has stayed hot. Gregory Polanco woke up from the dead and started really producing before he pulled his hamstring again. And, you know, but
usually that second ham that you hurt is worse.
Starling Marte has come back and it's been productive. Has been a big boost for the Pirate team, and well, they had their dream outfield together for four whole games, and we happened to win all four of them. So you know, we've got games tonight, tomorrow against San Francisco. We got Thursday night off, three against the Padres, and then we come back home.
How about that line drive home run that Josh Bell hit?
Nice.
Josh Bell is I'm telling you what, Josh Bell is the real deal. And I think, you know, he's going to be everything we needed out of a first baseman.
Now you're on my side with Josh Bell.
No, I'm not, you know, and I'll tell
you
what.
He plays first base a lot better each game. It's amazing, you know, the improvements he made. Adam Frazier
is a great fourth outfielder. You know, I mean, and he was forced to play more time than I would like to have seen him. I still kind of somewhat expect the Pirates to make some type of an addition, but something that makes sense. And one of the things that... you know, the Pirates is what's going to be the ask. You know, what do they have to give up? Because I wouldn't monkey too much with the team, because right now they're as good as anybody. When they play like they've been playing, they can beat anybody.
Never catch my Cubbies. They got that new pitcher in.
Mm-hmm.
Katana. Come on. You don't even know who he is.
Yep. There's a reason why they're going to play the last 62 games, Jim.
62 to go. That's why it's a 162-game season.
Speaking of a 62 games to go, the Dodgers, the Los Angeles Dodgers, 69-31 in the first 100 games. Watch out for the Los Angeles Dodgers this year. This may be their year.
It could be. Stay tuned for that. Well, we got some Bucco talk to you. Smoke and Jim got to throw some negativity on it. We appreciate that, except for Frazier. Thanks for watching our show. We appreciate all of you. Thanks for the control room, Devin Shea, Noah, and Steve. We appreciate you guys. And I always end the show with stay Joey Strong.